Good morning and welcome to the 13th meeting of the Education, Children and Young People Committee in 2021. This meeting is in a virtual setting. The first item on our agenda today is a decision on taking business in private. Can I ask whether members are content to allow agenda item 3 to be taken in private? Are we all agreed? I think we're all agreed. Moving on to our main item of business this week, the committee will take evidence on the alignment of skills policy with business needs. And this morning we are taking evidence from Frank Mitchell, who's Chair of Skills Development Scotland, Katie Hutton, Director of National Training Programmes Skills Development Scotland, Dr Alan Calhoun, representing the Scottish Apprenticeship Advisory Board, Karen Watt, Chief Executive, the Scottish Funding Council, and Sharon Drysdale, Assistant Director, Access Learning and Outcomes, Scottish Funding Council. Good morning to all of you. And can I welcome you all to our committee meeting this morning? If I may go first this morning and start the questioning and then invite my colleagues to follow. Last week, we had evidence from a number of different stakeholders, employers organisations, and they felt that they could do with better transparency. They felt very strongly, in fact, it was very strongly expressed that they wanted better transparency of how the apprenticeship levy is being spent. Can I ask Dr. Calhoun, if I may call you Alan, is that permissible, Alan?
Yes, of course, no problem.
Yep. Alan, why do you think employers feel that way?
Because they are taxed through the apprenticeship levy and feel some ownership of that money.
And do they feel their feeling is fully justified, in your opinion? That there's not sufficient transparency?
Yes, I would say there isn't sufficient transparency. There was a publication, I think, in the first year of how the notional funds were divided amongst various activities, but I haven't seen anything since then. But it clearly is used to fund modern apprenticeships, graduate apprenticeships, and other things as well.
The employers felt they weren't in the room when these apprenticeships decisions, when the decisions were being made about these apprenticeships. Is that a justified opinion, do you think? Do you think that your experience of your membership would support that idea that was given to us last week?
No, I would disagree with that view. Obviously, SAB, which I've been involved since its inception, is employer-led and covers a wide range of sectors and employers, large and small, and is charged with providing advice to SDS and the Scottish Government and Scottish Funding Council on all things to do with apprenticeships, and are now in charge of the definition of all apprenticeships.
So your view is that they were not justified in saying that they felt they were not in the room?
Well, obviously everyone cannot be in the room, but SAB is employer-led, is chaired by an employer who's here today. All the chairs and all the vast majority of the members are from employers. So they're well represented, and representatives of employer groups, CBI, Scottish Building Federation, etc. They're all members. So there is a route, I would suggest, from every employer in Scotland into SAB.
But when I read your written evidence, which you very kindly sent us, and it was very helpful in preparing for this session, one of the recommendations that you had made in relation to apprenticeships in Scotland was that there needed to be a demand-led funding system driven by employer demand. So was that Was that recommendation based on a conclusion from the evidence you had gathered from your members that that wasn't the case currently? And how do you create a demand-led funding system driven by employer demand? What changes would you like to see made?
Basically to implement that recommendation, that the current process is essentially top down from the Scottish Budget to the various agencies, and it doesn't recognise the contribution that the large employers make through the levy to the funding, and therefore naturally feel, because it's such a hypothecated tax, that they would like to see a return on that taxation for apprenticeships. So there isn't a direct link from an employer's need to the provision of apprenticeships from the apprenticeship system.
But perhaps you could help me understand what you were saying earlier. You know, I was saying that they had said to us last week they felt they weren't in the room. I was putting that view to you, and you said that wasn't justified because the Scottish Apprenticeships Advisory Board was in the room. I mean, what would have to change for? Just describe to me what you would prefer, what your organisation would prefer was the arrangement in order to deliver a demand-led apprenticeship system.
There are many, many different models tried in different places around the world. But I think it's really that the employer would have the ability to create and demand an apprenticeship from the system rather than ask for use of an apprenticeship from an allocation set centrally. So that, and obviously those would need to then be consolidated, because you cannot sensibly ask a provider of apprenticeship training, be it a private provider, a college or a university, to run a course for an individual in a subject. So there would need to be some consolidation and demand, you know, balancing of supply and demand to make sense of economics. But I think the flip from asking to use an apprenticeship to saying I have essentially a voucher type system where you could use that voucher as an employer to get an apprenticeship funded.
This is pretty much what they have in England. Would that be fair to say that the employers effectively have access to that money to spend on apprenticeships?
It has similarities, but it is, I think what we need to do is to balance the broader social and economic aspects from the government as a whole with the needs of individual employers. There are major problems with the system in England, and it's subject to revision. I've been directly involved in some of that work and know the challenges that operate there. So I think we can come up with a demand-led system that is Scottish and reflects the strength of our educational system, but has a better balance between a supply side system and a demand side system.
Okay, that's very helpful. I think Frank Mitchell would like to come in on the questions that I have, or the line of questions that you and I have just been discussing, Alan. Frank, what's your take?
Thank you, Mr. Kerr. So I'm Frank Mitchell, I'm Chair of Skills Development Scotland. I'm also CEO of SPNG Network, which is a large employer in Central and South Scotland, and also in England and Wales. So a couple of comments I would say. The ultimately, the decision of allocation of budget is essentially driven by Scottish Government. So how that's formed is a question for Scottish Government. SAB do not allocate the budget. Within SDS, we do multiple reviews every year about what demand looks like and the nature of that demand, and produce that in concert with employers and industry and sectors and regions. However, there's still issues where there are demand outstrips supply, and that's the reality of where we are just now. And the nature of that is probably best seen where we have higher demand for graduate apprentices just now than we have supplies. So we know we have demand about 4,000, and currently provision is around 1370 from a financial point of view. And ultimately, we try through the year to try and push on that if funds become available to help meet that demand. So, how that financial allocation is given is a question more for the government than necessarily the agency or SAB. But what we try to do is make sure we understand the demand and feed that into the machinery, and then administer it against the standards and the areas that we work with the employers and SAB, etc., to best use those funds where they're going to make the biggest impact. So.
I thought I heard Alan suggesting that some kind of voucher system, that whereby this money is basically released back to employers and they can then use the money effectively to create, you know, to actually match fund the demand, as it were, which would then, you know, lift the number. So you're saying 1370 at the minute, the demand is 4,000. It seems to be suggesting that vouchers would be available to employers to be able to get the apprentices they want, or I may have misinterpreted them, and you'll come back in if I have. But what's your reaction to that?
So there are various systems, and you know, demand-led purchasing is one of them, where vouchers, whatever way. When we have growing apprenticeships from 10,000 to almost 30,000 in 2019 in the back of demand, so there are real jobs in the real economy. We have something like 12,000 businesses support these apprenticeships. So often what we need to make sure is that 90% of those who are small and medium enterprises don't lose out to larger companies, because they've got the resources to do more in this area, where it's purely down to the employer to drive that through all the administration. So we have to balance that, given that we have to make sure we support which are largely the makeup of our economy in Scotland, the small and medium enterprises, where we need to balance that, and we do help with that administration through SDS, and obviously have a lot of contact with them to make sure we understand their demand. And you know, in this world, you never please everybody, but we're trying to make sure we strike the balance against a financial envelope.
Well, thank you. And to be fair to Alan Calhoun, I should bring him back in, because I may have misquoted him. I'll let him correct my misinterpretation of his comments. Alan?
Right, thank you, Convener. Just to clarify, what I was trying to say is that in a demand-led system, then the employer would be proposing that they would, and we must always remember that the employer is employing an apprentice, and they're making the largest commitment in this transaction. The employer would have the ability to use an apprenticeship place that they wanted, rather than asking to use one that somebody else has set up. And that it's really that flipping the actual mechanism. As I said, there are many different mechanisms in use, and the voucher concept is a was just an illustration of how that could be implemented. There isn't
being bottom up rather than top down, I think. Is that a fair comment?
Yes, essentially that's what demand led is. But as I said, we have a finite amount of public money. It has to be spent wisely, and it has to be spent efficiently. So you cannot, as I suggested, allow every employer to do whatever they wanted with whatever training provider. So there has to be some balancing between top down and bottom up. Both extremes produce unintended consequences.
Absolutely. I think Karen Watt, the Chief Executive of the Scottish Funding Council, would like to come in on that point, and then I'm going to turn to my colleague Willie Rennie. Karen.
Thanks very much, Convener, and hello, Committee. I feel as though the Scottish Funding Council is a fairly new entrant into this debate, because this is our first year of funding foundation apprenticeships, so apprenticeships for people in young people in the senior phase of school, and graduate apprenticeships through universities. So I'm not going to proffer a view on vouchers or demand-led systems, because obviously we're part of that process where the government has set a budget and they have asked us to distribute it through colleges and universities. But I would say a couple of things about the levy payers, because while levy paying companies are all obviously funding through the tax system, the apprenticeship programmes are also enabling flexible workforce development funds, which come through us, and they are much more bespoke to individual employers. And we spend about £13 million through colleges, where colleges can engage with employers on very specific training programmes for particular needs. And that that works for both levy paying employers and a small amount now for SMEs as well. And the second point I would make is the employer engagement that is so critical to make this work, I think, happens at a number of different levels. Obviously, there's a very important national level through SAB, and as Alan has described, I think the other important engagement is at institutional level. We will not get this working effectively unless our institutions and the bodies that are funded to provide apprenticeships and training and development opportunities for business are engaging effectively. Now, what is happening is we have lots of forums where employers engage. We have very programme-specific engagement. When we did our review of tertiary education and research, one of our recommendations was we need to have a much more strategic and comprehensive set of engagements between our institutions and employers if this is going to work, not just programme specific, but over the longer term. And we need to invest in our institutions to be able to have those engagements. And I just wanted to make those points at the outset around levy payers and the Flexible Workforce Development Fund, but also the importance of engaging at institutional level with employers so that they can really tailor the products to the needs in regional economies. Thank you.
Are you saying, Karen, that there are too many? Is it too cluttered? Are there too many strands? Is that what you're saying? That it's generally the education landscape in Scotland is quite cluttered. Are you saying it's true in this sphere as well?
I suspect there are many routes for employers and others to try to engage with institutions and products. Now, I think it's a complex system, so I think you need complex routes. So I'm not suggesting that any of these routes in and of themselves are not valuable. I think what we found in our review was actually for the colleges and universities, they had disparate sorts of funding streams coming to them for specific Young Persons Guarantee, National Transition Training Fund, Flexible Workforce Development Fund. You know, we put upskilling and reskilling funds into universities, about £6 million, and those are for short, bite-sized courses. I think what I'm saying is there needs to be a much more long-term investment in these relationships over a longer period of time, so that you get a deeper understanding of what employers and industry need, and that the institutions involved can actually make these products work in real time and in regional economies for employers and industry.
Strategic relationships, I think, is what you might be describing there. And on that point, I'm going to turn to Willie Rennie, who's got a supplementary, but then he's going to take on forward the questioning this morning. Willie Rennie.
Thanks, Convener. Isn't the situation with the apprenticeship levy quite a guddle? You've got a mixture of policies set by the UK government with the levy, but then the Scottish government on the application of effectively the funds that come through the funding system. Not every company that pays the levy requires an apprentice. The flexible workforce development fund isn't really that flexible, and it certainly isn't big enough. It was designed in the first place to kind of compensate those levy payers the best out of the apprenticeship scheme, because not every company needs an apprentice. And they've also now diluted the flexible workforce development fund by including non-levy payers in the system. Is it a surprise that many companies are now doing less training than they were before the apprenticeship levy was brought in? Is that a surprise? And do you have any reflections on what I've said?
Who's that directed to, Willie?
I'm sorry. I think if we go for Alan, actually Alan first, and then I think I would quite like to hear from Katie.
Okay. Thanks, Willie. I think we should be clear about the difference between apprentices, employers, and levy payers. The levy payers are only a very small fraction of the number of employers in Scotland, although they represent a lot of the employment. And so the funding that the government receives and then makes its decisions on how to distribute is for them. The allocation of the Flexible Workforce Development Fund to levy payers, and as Carmen said, a small amount to non-levy payers, is a welcome response to work that SAB did during the creation of this scheme in response to the apprenticeship levy. Clearly, employers would like more than is currently there. £20 million is not a huge amount, but equally well, it's structure in that each employer can only receive £15,000 each year at the moment is significant for some employers and not so significant for others. But most employers that I've been aware of have made good use of that fund and done things that they couldn't otherwise do. The question of the distribution to non-levy payers, again, is a political decision for the government to make, and it falls out with the remit of SAB. So I think I'll pause there.
Okay. Okay, Katie.
Can you hear me?
Sorry. Yeah, you're on now. Yeah.
Okay, thank you. As Alan said, the distribution of what happens to the levy in Scotland is obviously a matter for Scottish Government. What we know, I think, is that apprenticeships get something like 4% of post-16 education and training funding. You talked about the numbers side of things. I don't think you should take last year's numbers as any indication. Obviously, most education training last year was hit by COVID. What we know is prior to that and since the introduction of the levy, apprenticeship numbers have been going up. And also, you could argue that the levy has stimulated some of the public sector organisations to do more in apprenticeships, because they also have that tax on their wage bill as well. From memory, the Flexible Workforce Development Fund, one of the papers that SAB sent to Scottish Government around that was some employers saying, look, we do want our supply chains to be eligible for that flexible support, because we see that as being important to the products and services that they provide to us as well.
Yeah, but I know some companies that pay the levy that are now doing less training than they were before. That can't be right.
Is that in apprenticeships, or is it in general in terms of training?
They're just doing less training. They're not the companies that would naturally take on apprentices. And they're now the way that the funds are set up means that they're doing less training than they were before. How could that ever be credible?
It's up to individual circumstances within employers. I think some of the engagement in learning kind of goes up and down as well, Willie, in terms of what happens depending on individual company circumstances, what's happening there as well. But I do know that the levy has stimulated some companies, for me particularly, knowing to become involved in apprenticeships as a result of it.
I think Frank maybe wants to come in.
Yes, Frank.
Hopefully you can hear me now.
Carry on.
Thanks, Mr. Knight. I guess it's difficult to respond to the point about overall training coming down for some specific companies without knowing the detail. I guess the point about what was going on around the COVID meant that there were some practicalities around general training provision. I think, as Katie said, from an apprentice point of view, it represents only 4% of the overall money spent in the skills system. So it's there's obviously a lot of money elsewhere, and Karen's commented on that and what she's doing with SFC. But from the point of view of companies having to get ready for net zero, artificial intelligence, all the digitalisation, as an employer myself, we're really investing a lot more in training now going forward than we've ever done. And also, I see that in a number of other companies. Now, we're a levy payer, and I think it's also said already that 90% of the businesses involved in apprenticeships are SMEs and are not levy payers. So there is always going to be a help for those smaller companies to be able to take on apprentices in the model, and that's just the nature of what goes on. But large companies, you know, from my point of view, speaking personally as a large company, we look at this as a general tax, and that's how we look at this. But that if we were to not do our training, and if we were not to and bring on young people into our business, whether that's apprentices or graduates, and we typically take on somewhere between 200 and 250 a year, then our business wouldn't be sustainable. So I struggle to recognise why companies aren't investing in training genuinely. If not because of the practical reasons last year, going forward, they certainly have to, because the degree of change we have in front of us in the workplace is enormous. And if businesses don't invest in that, and upskilling and reskilling, which is going to be a key topic going forward, then I worry for their sustainability in future.
Okay, thanks, Kevina.
But that, frankly, that levy is effectively a training tax. That's what you're saying. And these businesses that may have been spending that money previously, or would have planned to spend that money on training, you can understand where Willie Rennie's coming from. If they then say, actually, our margins aren't sufficient, our profitability isn't sufficient, our budgets aren't sufficient to sustain an additional payment towards training. That's understandable, isn't it, from a business point of view?
Well, I think it was certainly a reaction at the beginning of when the levy started. There was a bit of a knee-jerk reaction by a lot of companies because of that general view that it would be ultimately funding out of their training budget and it would cut their internal training requirements. I think the vast majority of businesses have got over that now, and they just put it into the pot of general taxation and try to maximise what they can do with it. But ultimately, the world in front of businesses now require more training than ever before. The degree of change we have and volatility we have in front of us in businesses is enormous. And I've touched upon a few of the challenges. And businesses, if they want to be successful in the future, need to invest in the people in training, general training, but also in apprenticeships. As I mentioned, what we do talk about here is only 4% of what we spend in the skills system on apprenticeships. So it's a small part of the overall challenge. But ultimately, businesses need to make sure they attract the right people and keep them trained. And the amount of retraining and upskilling and retraining is going to happen now in the future in the workplace is going to be by far much more than it's ever had in the past.
Do you mention the 4% because you think it should be more?
I'm the chair of Skills Development Scotland, and I'm a large employer who takes on apprenticeships. Alan's here representing SAB. We are very much pro growing the apprenticeship family, work-based learning, and if we look at other successful economies, then we see this growth in work-based learning is a core part of it. They're seen as equal to just pure academic ones, and that's not to say pure academic is not a great pathway, but I think what we want to see is more work-based learning through apprenticeship, because we believe it's a really really strong pathway for individuals, pathways for businesses and pathways for the economy. But that's not to say there aren't very strong pathways within other areas, but of course I would want to see more on apprenticeships.
Some people might say it's a higher road rather than an equal road, but
I'm not known for my diplomacy, but I'll say equal just now, Mr.
Okay, that's good, Frank. Michael Marra with a short supplementary, and then we'll be going to Bob Doris.
I think my questions are probably slightly more substantive, convener. I may hang off till my turn if that works.
That's absolutely fair and fine. That's good. Thank you, Michael, for that. Bob Doris.
But thank you, convener. I better dig out my paper in front of me slightly quicker than I thought. All good. Really interesting. I'll keep my powder dry to the private session. Some thoughts on the apprenticeship levy, convener. But really interesting exchange. But I wanted to turn to the role of colleges in helping meet skills gap and, you know, align the training needs of business with those in education. And I was interested in the Funding Council's submission on the Young Persons Guarantee, which said the Scottish Funding Council secured £10 million from the fund in 2020-2021 to work with colleges and universities to develop a proposal to meet the aims of the fund. This collaboration resulted in a series of interventions linked to key priority sectors, which included courses to increase the deployability of skills of those furthest from the market. And it's those furthest from the labour market that I'm very interested in. So, yes, of course, I'd like to hear a little bit more from the Scottish Funding Council in relation to the role of colleges and the spend of that £10 million. But I met with the principal of Glasgow Kelvin College just the other day, and he tells me a lot of very short courses, sometimes as little as 10 hours at a time, which were really pre-employability intensive work with people furthest away from the labour market, have effectively disappeared during COVID, and colleges serving the most deprived parts of the country have major challenges ahead of them. So it's in that context I would quite like to know a lot more about that £10 million and how that's helping those furthest away from the labour market and the role of colleges in relation to that. And depending on what I've heard, convener, I've got a couple of short supplementaries in relation to that. So maybe one of the reps from the Funding Council would be best placed.
Karen?
Start, and then I might ask Sharon to come in on this, if I may. So the Young Persons Guarantee has been really important, and we've had about 240 courses over the course of this year's spend in colleges for the second half of the academic year. And so that's had about 2,500 students going through this. And that's, you know, I guess between 70% and 71% were about from the 16 to 19 year old cohort. And we understand that that's, you know, and has been an important part of the college's provision. I've actually just written out to colleges in the last couple of weeks to redefine some of the flexibilities that I think have been very important to put into the college sector, particularly as we look at the consequences of the pandemic and the fact that it has not affected everybody equally. So there are particular parts of our communities that have suffered most from this. And so some of the flexibilities that we've just put into the system and we've written out to all principals, including Glasgow Kelvin, to suggest that they can use their credits in more flexible ways. So, for example, where there is a need for shorter, sharper courses, we're now enabling colleges to use their credits for that. We're also very clear that there are additional needs for some students, particularly who may not have had the same access to placements or to practical engagements. And again, we have increased the number of credits that the college can claim for what they now need to put in for additional learning for particular students. So again, trying to reach out to those who have been most affected through this particularly difficult period and putting more flexibility into even our existing funding to enable those colleges to reach out to both young people, but those also furthest away from the job market. But I wonder, Convener, if I could ask Sharon to come in on yes, some of this as well. Thank you.
Good morning. I'm happy to come in on that. Can you hear me? Just checking.
Loud and clear.
Thank you. Great. Yeah, thank you, Karen, for passing that over. So in terms of the furthest away from the labour market, what we have identified within the college around Young Persons Guarantee and the National Transition Training Fund was where colleges worked very closely with those who were furthest away from the labour market, marrying up with employers to try and ensure that there was a skills, there was a progression pathway for learners undertaking a skills boost, what they called skills boost, to increase their employability chances. What we saw some really great examples across the sector. West Lothian College working with Scottish Ambulance Service in terms to identify the identified skills gaps for their mobile training units and to ensure that those people who would ultimately become redundant due to, I was about to say, lack of mobile testing units, but that's about to ramp back up again. But at that point, those people who were about to become redundant were given a course that was developed with the ambulance service that identified how they could move on to health and social care. Edinburgh College, equally, through Young Persons Guarantee, developed a course with a collaborative approach with NHS Lothian, looking at their hardest to reach skills gaps, jobs that people were really hard to fill, and marrying that up to students in the system who were furthest away from the labour market. That course was really successful, and after the first two cohorts, 30 people were put into full-time employment, so quite a great success rate. So, and we still look for collaborative ways of working and encourage collaborative ways of working within the college sector to work with employers, identify skills gaps and ensure there's a pathway for learners to get into employment.
That's very helpful. I should, of course, point out, I mentioned the Young Persons Guarantee because there's a quantifiable £10 million investment in that. But more generally, it's clearly not just young people, but those in the most deprived areas that have the most fragile learning experiences and were the most likely to be impacted by the pandemic more generally. So whilst I'm following up some questions in the Young Persons Guarantee, I just wanted to be show awareness that I know that. Now, I see from our papers that 2,438 students were recorded as having enrolled in the Young Persons Guarantee and that 53.6% of those were from the four most deprived SIMD deciles and 18.2% from the most deprived decile. Are you comfortable with that balance? Should it be greater? Some thoughts in relation to that. Do we need more intensive funding? And how would we follow the outcomes in relation to that? So if you were back at this committee next year and we said that was 2,438 last year, how many have entered in the following year? What's the breakdown by SIMD? And what were the outcomes for those in the previous year? That would be really helpful to know. And I suppose I should also just finish off, Convener, by saying when I spoke to Derek Smith, the College Principal for Glasgow Kelvin College, he was very excited in the challenges facing the sector, but they were well up and well placed to address that challenge. I just want to make sure the appropriate funding streams get to those colleges to allow them to address those challenges.
Would you like someone to comment on that, Bob?
So I think the question was in the first half, Convener, in relation to how do we monitor outcomes for those 2,438, what we anticipate the numbers to be for next year, any breakdown in relation to outcomes, and how is that spread across the country, so we can get beneath the figures, Convener, and do some monitoring scrutiny work as a committee.
Is that one for Frank or Alan?
Again, I'm not sure who does the monitoring. It's funded by the Funding Council. So is it the Funding Council that would measure those outcomes?
I think Sharon is saying that she wants to come back in on that, so that would be very helpful. And maybe Alan can tell us what he would like to see the outcome as next time he is invited to appear before the committee. Sharon?
In terms of monitoring and looking at the outcomes for each of these students and learners, what we do is monitor each college individually. We have monthly meetings with the colleges around YPG and NTTF to understand what the output looks like. It also comes through our FAES system, where that's our normal reporting system. But because of the nature of this and because of how relevant it is to economic recovery, we're working closely with every single college in the sector. We meet with them monthly to understand what the, where those outputs are coming, and they report into us on a bi-monthly basis. So we would be able to give you some of those outputs and outcomes by the end of this academic year, once we can clear the sort of requirements for our reporting, cleanse that data and be able to give you that. So yes, if you do ask us in next year, we will be able to give you an update on both YPG and National Transition Training Funds, and also around our upskilling fund as well.
So can I ask for that now rather than wait till next year? In other words, I think the committee will have an interest in monitoring this on an ongoing basis rather than rehearsing this again next year. I suppose that was the point I was making, and that was £10 million, of course, from the Young Persons Guarantee. Would the Funding Council have use for additional funds to additional places next year, and would you be keen to see those targeted at the most SIMD bottom 20 or 40? I'm trying to know what the Funding Council thinks about this rather than just telling me the numbers.
That's Karen or Sharon?
Karen, perhaps?
Shall I pick up first, and then if Sharon has any additional comment to make? So I think this is a really valuable programme. We would like to see it both sustained and, if possible, increased. And, of course, that is entirely a matter for the government in terms of how much they continue to put into Young Persons Guarantee. And clearly, this will be one of those funds that we are still waiting to see how much will be coming through into the college sector, because it wasn't on the face of the budget that was announced recently. So we are, as you will know, our national review was very clear. These are extremely valuable funds. We would like to see them continue. I think there's a huge value in these targeting into areas that are most in need of encouragement and helping young people get involved. And so I guess this is part of the review that we'll be doing this year, to see whether or not colleges working with us, whether the government's policy needs to go into slightly more targeted phase. So I suppose my answer would be, we would like to see these funds continue. We'd like to see them bedded in effectively into the future years. And I guess it's an open question about whether or not they become even more targeted and whether it is sufficient. And I guess I'm not giving you an absolute answer, because I want to see how some of these schemes are actually, the monitoring that we're doing, how they're actually working in real time, and what colleges are finding is working well and what is more of a challenge in these funds. We're very happy, if it is useful and we feel the data is ready to share, to give you early sight of monitoring around this rather than wait to the end of the year. But it may at times be slightly more anecdotal than hard evidence-based, but we will give the committee updates if that is helpful on a more regular basis than waiting to the end of the academic year.
Thank you, Karen. Can you, that'd be very helpful. No further questions.
Thank you. Turn now to the Deputy Convener, Cocab Stewart.
Good morning, everyone. That's been a really interesting and informative sort of chat so far. I wanted to sort of like look at, you know, I mean, one of the reasons why we're all here is because we know that we need to upskill, reskill, but we also have skills shortages and we have labour market shortages. So in the light of that, of course, there are, you know, untapped human resources out there, women, for instance, but also people from Black, Asian, minority, ethnic, heritage and cultural backgrounds as well. So I'm very interested to hear about what actual actions are taking place to encourage people from those backgrounds to come into the skills market and come into the labour market using the national training programmes, for instance. And I'd like to, in the first instance, put that question to Katie Hutton, and then maybe Dr. Allen could come in and give an update on the Gender Commission that was referred to in the papers as well. Thanks.
Kate, thanks very much for that. We've just published a report, a five-year report of 5 years of the Equalities Action Plan in apprenticeships, and it's highlighted the range of actions that we've taken and the progress that's been made around that really important issue around reaching out to groups that participate less in some of the programmes. And I could talk about other things, you know, with upskilling, but we'll focus on it in terms of apprenticeships. We've made progress in terms of apprenticeships, but we've got much more to do. Our target is to reach the population share for BME participation. It's 2.7% at the moment, going up from 1.6%. There's interesting things behind that as well, CoCab, in terms of if you look at the 2020 participation figures for 16 to 19-year-olds, you've got ethnic minority populations tend to stay on more at school and tend to get into higher education. So that's 27% in HE compared to 19.1% for white ethnicities. So one of the things that we've said is, well, actually, if you want more people in apprenticeships from that background, you might have to take from higher education. And there's all sorts of, you will well know, cultural factors about you know, about what is the destination of choice, etc. And interestingly, the graduate apprenticeship population at the moment in graduate apprenticeships is actually higher, the percentage is just slightly higher than actually the ethnic minority participation as well, as it is for foundation apprenticeships. So I think there's really good signs there in the graduate apprenticeship programme and also in FAs of the work that we've been doing with community groups. Around outreach to community groups, matching up training providers with the range of agencies to make sure that we get as much participation as possible.
Okay, that's interesting, your statistic about 2.7%. I think the last sort of like census is sitting at sort of just over 4%, but obviously 10 years later, we're expecting that to be much higher. So that's quite a significant gap there. It's also interesting about the higher level of sort of like graduate apprenticeships. Do you think that there's a problem with perception within sort of certain communities regarding apprenticeships and skills development?
Yeah, I mean, I do think there is a cultural, in some, and it's terrible to generalise, as you know, but in some ethnic minority communities, you know, there is a real parental drive to make sure that people go into university and do certain types of subjects. Because again, I think, and Karen and Sharon will know more than I, but there are certain subject areas, for instance, that there's a higher proportion of ethnic minority individuals in the population score. So I think there is that perceptions about apprenticeships and what's the preferred route. And that's the kind of things that we've been working on to get in at the grassroots to say, actually, the apprenticeship is a really good route, which is why foundation apprenticeships in the schools, because you've got to get the messages right down in the school system rather than just the secondary education. But that's why foundation apprenticeships and graduate apprenticeships are a fantastic addition to make sure that message around apprenticeships is heard.
Yeah, I think it's just important that obviously not one size fits all, and I'm very keen that decisions come from the young people themselves, and they see parity with different pathways. So that's very helpful, what you've said there. Dr. Allen, I wonder if you could come in and tell me a little bit about the work of the Gender Commission.
Thank you, CoCab. The SAB set up the Gender Commission a couple of years ago, and it's been led by Natalie Buxton of Weber Shandwick, and they've held a large number of meetings and consulted with a wide range of participants right across the society, and working closely with SAB's Equalities Group. They are finalising a report at the moment, and we expect that to be published in the new year, full of clear recommendations that can be implemented The diversity and inclusion agenda is very clear throughout all SARB's activities, and indeed principle four for an apprenticeship is that it's available for all people of all backgrounds, whether it's gender, race, neurodiversity, etc. So I think employers recognise that they need to address the full population to address the challenges that you highlighted about skill shortages, the position of the labour market. We have to make best use of all the talent we have in the UK.
And who would be responsible for sort of like monitoring the application of those recommendations then? What normally happens? I'm not sure about that, but myself.
Well, I think these are recommendations from SARB to the business community, the employer community as a whole. But I would say that certainly within my company, and I'm sure within Frank, there's huge efforts going on in this area. I think it's really us all addressing this issue and talking about it and making positive moves to address barriers to employment for whatever reason, and putting in measures, as Katie talked about, providing the role models early in people's careers and their education system to show them the pathways, to give them experience. I think the best way to learn something is to go and do it. So getting, for example, work experience or visits to factories. We've working, and I know, for example, NMIS as well, are working closely with AFPE, which is a group focused on engineering, the recruitment of engineers into the sector from the wide-ranging ethnic communities. So,
yeah, I just wondered, I suppose where I'm going with this is that that good work has been going on for many years. I've seen that myself, yeah, through the education system. However, there are sort of stubborn areas where there is a lack of movement. So, for instance, if you have a certain, and I don't want to sort of like pick on one because that is unfair, but say there was sort of like a workforce or a type of business that consistently had an underrepresentation of female employees, then how do you monitor that? How do you break that cycle? Because we've been doing all of these other things in the past. So I just wondered, mm-hmm, if there was anything else that we could push for as a committee or suggest.
Well, I think reporting is obviously the easiest way to see these problems, and obviously encouraging employers to set targets for representing the communities that they serve. Legislation is a possibility. There's obviously have been some moves in that direction around things like the gender pay gap, that highlights certain parts of this issue, and encouraging where you can to have positive action. I know I was involved with SFC and a lot of the work they did in the education system to address these issues with SDS and the gender issues within apprenticeships in certain sectors. A lot of attention. But I think the biggest driver is that employers require skilled staff, and mm-hmm, they are blind to all those things. What they are open to is people with the right skills and the right attitude to do the jobs that need done.
Thank you for that reflection. It is, you know, as I said earlier, I think it is an untapped sort of workforce, yeah, that is right there. So reaching out and encouraging, but also, I suppose, incentivising as well. You know, people's attitudes towards work have changed. So they want fair sort of like paying conditions. They want access to skills, up-leveling and, you know, increasing their own repertoire. So, thank you very much for that. That was very helpful. Thank you, convener.
I think Katie Hutton wanted to come in on your line of questioning, Co-Cap. So can I bring Katie in?
Thank you. It was just to say that I think that as part of the recommendations, it will be SAB that will monitor the recommendations. There's also there will probably be recommendations in there for policymakers as well. And I think what was going to come out is things around a whole system approach to this, because it's cultural normalisation, as we say, starts early on in the system. And you know, when we survey employers, they'll tell us that almost all employers, for instance, electrical or automotive or construction, told us that almost most or all of their applicants were males, for instance. And the reverse is true for dental, nursing, and childcare. And what I should have said earlier is that bit about you know, in Spaniel Scotland, they've just put out a piece of work that they interviewed 400 young people, mostly from deprived backgrounds, and 100. Frontline staff working with them, and it highlights that young people tend to stick with what's familiar to them. So you can imagine, you know, we've all been in a shop, we've all had a meal in a restaurant, so retail and hospitality figure quite highly. So if they can't see it, they can't be it, which is why early exposure way down the school system, involvement in work experience, exposure to the workplace and work-based learning within the school system through foundation apprenticeship is all important in trying to change what's happening, because employers, you know, applications have to come forward for employers. And I know, you know, Drank's company, I know, for instance, do an awful lot around gender, etc. So there's a whole system approach there required.
If you can't see it, you can't be it. I do like that. Should I have heard that before? That sounds like something could be made into a good strap line.
It's convenient, and the other one is nothing about us without us.
Nah, I like that as well. Yeah, that's very good, very inclusive. Stephanie Callahan, if you would like to take us forward with your line of questions, Stephanie.
Thank you, convener, and thanks to our panel for coming along today. I was actually going to quote the quote that CoCab just did there: "Nothing about us without us." And I think it's very popular at the moment and very pertinent. I'm going to speak as well about diversity and equality and ask some questions around that, and again, untapped talent there. So we already have a bit of a focus on gender imbalances, which are well recognised across various sectors, and there's work going on to encourage women into sectors. As mentioned as well, we've got black and minority ethnic communities, more socio-economic groups. My words are coming well this morning there. And we've also got disabilities, learning disabilities, and neurodiversity. So I just wanted to ask a wee bit about neurodiversity. We've got quite high unemployment within this group of people, and very often they can't make it through recruitment processes like interviews, with common skills that employers are looking for, like communications, teams work, networking, being things that are actually really, really challenging for them. So effectively, they can get screened out at that recruitment stage, but they do have lots of unusual and valuable skills. So in evidence, we've been hearing about skills gaps in digital computing, IT, data analytics, etc. there as well. And very often these can be strengths for people who are neurodiverse. So including that, like autism, ADHD, dyslexia, etc. there as well, quite a range of things. So I'm wondering just now, first of all, what is the current representation on boards now as far as diversity goes and neurodiverse individuals? So on SDS, on SAB, on SFC. So I suppose just a quick question to three of you there that represent those organisations.
Who would you like to go first?
Okay, if I could ask Frank first, please.
Hopefully you can hear me. I don't know if that. I think I see Alan up.
I can.
We can hear you, Frank. Carry on.
Okay. Thank you. So I think just starting from maybe first of all with the my employer hat on, it's important that all parts of society are given the right opportunities and the right pathway to have a role in the economy going forward. And as a business, I know we try a lot to do that and invest in it. And there's a huge responsibility in business, particularly large businesses, such as myself, to be doing that. And I can talk to you about that. As far as making sure, and it's quite a, you know, it's, you know, the area to do with the encouraging people into particular areas where they may have a strength, such as digitalisation, as you mentioned, in mathematics, is the area where we've been working with the industry on looking at how can we transition people who otherwise may be out of employment, but actually have some of those skills that can be useful to employers in those sectors. And there are work programmes we've done with, in particular in digitalisation, where people have been able to do courses for I think 15 to 16 weeks to transition in and be much more employable to that sector, but come from a different place, but they've got the fundamentals around mathematics and coding that give them that, those competencies that otherwise without a bit of training they might not have the entry parts to get into it. And this has been done with employers. But I probably suspect we probably need to take away, because it's quite a detailed question you've asked, I'll probably need to take that away and come back with a written response. But I'd maybe ask Katie from SDH, she may have some more insight to that very detailed group.
Thanks. Katie?
Fingers to hand on that. What I would say is there's been a heck of a lot of work done in this in the digital sector, as you mentioned. We published a report in 2020 about neurodiversity in the digital sector, and since then there's been a range of actions, you know, including working with colleges on supporting individuals with neurodiversity around entering the tech sector, and technology provides fantastic opportunities for individuals in terms of their engagement with the sector and the skills that they have, as Frank has outlined. So there is a programme of work behind that that we can get details to you of.
Okay, that's great. And sorry, where are we? Alan?
Thanks, Stephanie. Well, SAB itself is made up of representatives from mostly employers and training providers, etc. So we've got a diverse range of members there, and obviously they represent a whole range of different groups of people. You know, and in addition, there is the Equalities group, which is clearly focuses on this area. So I think we're well covered, and as I was saying before, all our activities are covered. Consider the effects of diversity, and including neurodiversity. And clearly, my primary interest is in the scientific and engineering sector, and fortunately, but slightly seriously, we're all on the spectrum somewhere, and the range is quite broad within the sector. We do make, certainly within Leonardo, we make efforts in terms of recruitment to accommodate as many routes in as possible and tackle things such as dyslexia and dyscalculia during the recruitment process. If anybody flags something up, we make great efforts to try and accommodate them. And similarly, to provide support within the workplace, and we have that. And we're doing some, taking some positive action on that with a trial with some apprentices this year as well. So I think that's a summary of where we are, but clearly recognise that what the neurodiverse population brings to engineers, engineering, and particularly the creativity side of things.
Right, thanks very much for that. Sorry, was someone else looking to come in there, Katie? Oh, I don't think so. Sorry, my apologies. Okay, so I think really probably the point that I would make there is that, you know, with the absolute best will in the world, if there isn't representation there from those individuals, that what can seem like really good solutions that improve accessibility to neurotypical people, or normal, if you like, and the same for disabilities, that those things in practice aren't always what people need. So I would really say, you know, representation, I think, is maybe something that we really need to be looking at there, and making sure we have that representation right at the level where ideas are coming through there. And my second question is just kind of following on from that as well. What kind of pathways do we actually have just now? Is there anything else that MD wants to mention as far as the pathways into employment for neurodiverse individuals, or any plans for the future? And I would be interested in maybe Shannon answering that question.
Thank you. Both the college sector is absolutely key to this in terms of the way that they reach people who are furthest away from the labour market and who do come into the college sector with a wide range of additional needs, including neurodiversity. We have we can see through our data that the numbers are increasing, and that the colleges are very well placed to adapt provision to make sure to ensure that they bring people through the process and that pathway from early access straight through to HNC and then onward into university is very clearly documented. I think we could provide data for that for you in some of those if that would help you. I don't have that to hand right at this minute in time. Can I come back to you on you didn't come in on the board?
Yeah.
Just to say that we do have a commitment to ensure a diverse board. We made really good progress achieving a sort of 50-50 balance in our gender. Worked really hard to ensure that was put into place. In our next recruitment round, we will have the opportunity to go a bit further on that. And we have signed a memorandum of understanding with the EHRC, and they're coming to a February board meeting to speak to the board about governance responsibilities around those issues. So they've also addressed all of our directorates in terms of HSFC, a directorate has had a diversity training from EHRC. So we are making progress. But there are some ways to go as well.
That's great. Really, really appreciate that. The training is incredibly important. But again, I think that representation at the highest levels there is also completely vital. Thanks very much, convener and panel.
I think Katie and Karen wanted to come in on your question. So let's see if Katie first and then Karen want to add anything.
I just wanted to agree with you about the whole point of when you're delivering services and skills programmes, etc., that you have to understand what needs are and co-design. Lived experience is such a huge part of equalities, for making sure that there's diversity and participation and outcome, and that's certainly something that is absolutely core to our equalities work. The thing about pathways is an interesting one that you raised, because what you're also trying to do is mainstream within your provision to not ghettoise individuals into, well, that's a course for that group of individuals, etc. So a big, our approach to equality strategy is to mainstream as much as possible, but crucially also lived experience is so important to the design of services to make sure that they're actually going to hit the mark.
And Karen?
Thanks, convener. I think actually Sharon may have covered the point. The memorandum we have with the Equalities and Human Rights Commission is incredibly important, because not only is it challenging us about how we engage with the sector and our expectations, reporting and action plans, but it is getting to the heart of where are the persistent inequalities that we need to actually spend greater time and energy on. As Sharon said, they're coming to our board. Our board is a publicly appointed board. We have another opportunity in 2023 to look at the diversity of our board and to explore other ways of doing that. The HRC is coming to address the board in February to look at different options about how, even in its existing and current state, it can become more open to understanding representation and needs across the piece, whether that's through different observers or different participation around our board table. And the last thing I would just say is we do have some extremely good case studies of colleges looking at, for example, neurodiverse communities. I'm thinking about West Lothian colleges looking at digital and computing skills, and they have done some quite groundbreaking work with neurodiverse communities. And if it is helpful, I'm sure we could get the committee some more specific work on that. The issue is, how do we use that good practice to more fully embrace all pathways for particularly challenged groups in society to kind of make the most of the opportunities that are available from our institutions. Thank you.
Thank you for that. I'm going to come now to James Dornan, and he will be followed by Michael Mara. And so, James, if you're all set, I think you are, and then Michael Mara. James.
Okay, thanks very much, Convener. I'd like to start off by asking, excuse me, Alan, how does SAB ensure the membership's representative of industry in Scotland, both in terms of the current labour market and expected emergent demand? And also, how do you, particularly after COVID, how do you recognise what that emerging demand is going to be?
Thanks very much for that question. I think there are several parts to SAB, as I'm sure you've seen from the briefing papers. We have the group board at the top level, which provides the sort of overview, and we receive briefings from SDS on labour market intelligence, things that are changing. In the standard and frameworks group that I'm a member of as well, we are defining and designing and approving through the apprentice approvals group the actual frameworks for apprenticeships, and we have a work programme for there looking at what needs to be refreshed, what's new, what's no longer required. The employer engagement group is the voice of the broader employer market. So we have, as I mentioned in previous answers, a range of bodies, CBI, etc., feeding in there. So that's a broad a funneling effect from an individual representing an organisation, but they have hundreds, thousands of members. And then the equalities group we've covered. So between all those parts, we have the ability to foresight across the skills landscape and see where the issues are, what's being required, and obviously digitisation and machine learning, artificial intelligence is a hot topic just now. How does that feed into the skills system? And then referred about the type of people that you need for those skills. So there is that marrying between the technological advances, the work of individual companies and what they require, and larger groupings of organisations, trade bodies largely.
Okay, thanks for that. I see that Frank wants to come in. I was actually going to ask him to come in. I might come back to you, Alan, but Frank, would you like to come in at this stage?
Thanks. So I think the SAB is an employer-led organisation that's focused on apprenticeships. So I guess it's first of all that some people who have a real interest in apprenticeships who we try to encourage to join SAB, because it's voluntary. If people put their own time into it, companies invest people's time in it. So it is a big commitment, because a lot of work goes on, heavy lifting behind the scenes, particularly the standards, etc. So I think we try to, where we can't get people from the appropriate companies, we try to look to others to try and help in those areas to get that best advice around about. And equally, there's ongoing engagement with industry leadership groups and regional groups and enterprise agencies to make sure we understand what's going on both regionally and sector-wide. And as I think Alan outlined, SDS try to inform through the work they do on an annual basis about what demand is looking like and checkpoint that with the people in represented in SAB. So it's clear that we depend on volunteers, and we depend on companies. And the particular focus for SAB is those who have an interest in apprenticeships. And we would welcome any company who wants to be involved to do that. And we do try to make sure we outreach to them through what we do through employee engagement. And certainly, we, as Alan already said, we have the sort of CBI, the Chambers of Commerce, other sort of groups involved in that to try and help bring, coalesce areas together for us where we can't get specific companies involved. There's a range of sectors in the SAB membership when the evidence, I think, was laid out, and we try to make sure that's covered in the representation in there. And Alison McGregor, who's the chair of SAB, is the ex-CBI president, the chief exec of HSBC Scotland, and ex-CBI Scotland president. So, and Alison and myself talk about that continually, make sure we try and refresh and make sure the representation that we get around that table is forward-looking as we can through the voluntary process.
Okay, let me ask you then, thanks for that answer. And this touches more on maybe the role in SDS, but how do you gauge what you think the future demand is going to be, what the future market is going to be, and also how is that impacted and changed by, you know, what's happened over the last 2 years? I mean, has there has to be a rethinking of what type of apprentices we're going to need, how many are going to be needed, and what sort of markets are going to be needed?
So we try to do that through regional and sector skills assessments that go on annually and regularly, and also produce skills investment plans, both regional and sector-wide, that try to be agreed with those relevant bodies that are involved in that, stakeholders in those areas, make sure that we're picking up what we think the demand is going to be for the forward period that we're looking at, 12 months and beyond. We also look at what's happening globally in trends, and there's work goes on, and I'm sure Katie will talk about it, research and development we do within looking at what's happening out there in the trends in technology, for instance, and what's going on. But undoubtedly, COVID has had a big impact in some sectors. So retail has accelerated some of the change we've seen coming that way. That was probably seen to be longer in the horizon than what happened through COVID was happened in there. And obviously, hospitality has been impacted. So we're also very interested in what we look at is upskilling and reskilling opportunities to try and move people across sectors to make sure. I mean, what we want to do is always keep people in employment and get them into employment. That's the fundamentals of what we're trying to do, and what we and make sure there's good employment when they do that. And of course, in apprenticeship, you've always got to have an employer backing it up that there's a real job there. So that's at the heart of what we do with apprenticeship, because you don't get an apprenticeship without having a real employer who wants somebody there. And that's also what gives us a lot of confidence that the apprentices we're starting have real jobs involved in that as well, and that's a strength of what we do in that area. But the one thing I would say is any forecast is never going to be correct, and that's just the nature of the beast. So we need to have the ability to react to events, and we try to keep we're in the ground. We've got a regional structure across SDS. We've got an SDS sector structure against SDS. So we try to keep we're near to the ground about what's going on, see what the effects are with, you know, in short term, and try to dynamically shift when we see demand growing or demand reducing for certain areas that we forecast in advance. So we don't just stick to the plan for the sake of it. So we try to make sure we have a best view looking forward, agreed with the various stakeholders, including SAB, and then we make sure that we react to events as they occur through our network of people out there that are, you know, are locked into sort of regions and sectors to do that as well. So, you know, as I said, it's COVID has probably been unprecedented to cope with some of those changes, as you've highlighted.
Yeah, I mean, if forecasting was that easy, I'd have won the pool some time ago. Can I just ask then? I don't know if yourself or Kate or if somebody else wants to come in, but there seems to be some sectors that people don't seem to recognise as a good opportunity for apprenticeships in there. You know, future progression, good learning experiences, etc. Could you? I don't know if you'd be able to respond to how you can fill that hole, or if it should go to Kate.
Well, we see. And I'll ask maybe Kate to comment on whether you've got a specific in mind about the sector, but we see apprenticeship opportunities in every sector and in every region. Now, we'd like to do more, but as I mentioned earlier on, we want to go, because we think they're great pathways and really strong every time, you know, they looked at and assessed OECD. There seems a very strong pathway and help young people and help others at different ages as well across all parts of society get into a job. It's good for businesses and it's good for the economy. So it's an area that we very want to push that for. So if there are gaps out there, we think we need to push on. And to be honest, you know, I think there's opportunity. I'm sure other sectors can do better. I remember I used to have a go at the oil and gas sector for some time because I felt they weren't doing enough to create apprentices by the top tier companies. All they were doing was taking it from the supply chain. So I had a long time conversation with some of the chief execs about the need to invest more in apprenticeships and graduates rather than keep recruiting from the supply chain. But maybe ask Katie to comment on anything she's got in that area around growth.
Just before you do, Frank, that last point you made about cherry picking sort of workers from the supply chain, would that be a reason why you'd be more in favour of the apprenticeship grant than not? Because these companies then, I take it, wouldn't be participating in the apprenticeship grant, but would just be taking out the staff from elsewhere.
Well, some of these larger companies that weren't doing as many apprentices as I would suggest they should have done were actually sizing up to be levy payers. And actually some of the companies that were taking trained people out of, rather than training their own to a level that I think they should have been doing, were those who weren't levy payers because of a smaller companies who were using the apprenticeship programme to grow their own talent. Ultimately, people were throwing money at them when they wanted to get some resources, so people were moving for a bit more money. And I was encouraging some of those top tier companies, they need to do a lot more to grow their own talent. And they've taken it on board in recent times, but I think it's been an area where you do have some challenges in some sectors where some companies within a sector could be doing more. So I don't disagree with that. I think it's incumbent for everybody to do everything they can in this area to grow and give everyone the opportunities through apprenticeships as they can possibly do.
Okay. Right. Thanks very much for that. Kate was going to come in, yeah.
Annual statistical report, you'll see, I think, that what we've done around pathways is a real priority around higher level MAs over the last piece. You know, when you look at the data on the wages returns around things, and there's been a real priority in the policy in our managed demand process to actually to go into areas with higher level type, you know, VQ level type things. Also, the graduate apprenticeships as a pathway is that very attempt to provide higher level pathways too. Also, I think a big development in the development of frameworks going forward under the SAB process is the introduction of meta skills, because if you look at everything in the future in terms of what people will need, actually it's the adaptive and resilient things around self-management, management change in the workplace, because things are fast moving now and what technology has brought, innovation. So meta skills are going to form a key part of the development of frameworks and everyone that's been revised now, so that people can actually move jobs because of the state of the labour market as well, in terms of what they'll need in their own work situation, and they'll also need it for if they go into to transition into other industries. I think another area that's kind of important going forward around, you know, this committee's looking at the alignment skills is obviously around the whole green jobs aspect and what's needed there, whether it's for new pathways that are going to open up or for people transitioning into different roles, needing to enhance their skills that they've got already, and just the sheer scale of things going forward there too. And obviously we've touched on digital as well, being a huge area for Scotland in terms of what we require in that too. So I think there'll be, you know, new pathways opening up, but obviously we've also tried to emphasise within our contracting and within the starts that we fund each year, that move towards higher level opportunities and also the graduate approach too.
Okay, thanks very much for that, Kate. I see that Sharon wants to come in. I wonder, convener, if I can get Sharon in.
Absolutely fine.
Thank you very much. If I could just go back one slight step where you were talking about regional skills assessments and demand assessment, how we can then identify what the future looks like, which, as you said, if we all had a crystal ball, that would be wonderful. However, one of the most positive, we are relatively newbies in this environment around SAB, but one of the positive progresses that has been made is that SFC now has membership of SAB. and we also sit in subgroups like the Employer Engagement Group and the Standards and Frameworks. That brings together a really unique opportunity to align the aims and sort of objectives of our accountability, but equally the delivery partners and colleges and universities in understanding how those aspirations are aligned. We worked really closely with SDS in development of the regional skills assessments, but we don't just utilise that. As Frank said, it's not an exact science. But for us, what we do is work very closely, talk to all of our institutions to see what their capacity is, where they see things progressing, what they feel in terms of numbers and what they can do, and where they see opportunities to be able to change or look at new frameworks for the future. So I think having all of that brought together, it's absolutely really positive progression and positive piece of work, a collaborative piece of work that we're doing.
Thanks very much. Can I ask just one other question?
Sure.
Thank you. Just on that point you made there, Sian, the points about Kate, etc., previously about flexibility and about being able to move from one field to another. Is the funding as flexible as, you know, you have to be around about the training? So if the training was going to have to change slightly, is the funding, is it easy for the funding to follow that?
For us, it's actually really quite easy to be able to move between frameworks. So if an institution comes back to us and says, we're seeing a decline in demand in one particular framework, we can ensure that they have the flexibility, providing that there's a need, that there's an economic need to develop the other framework and that the numbers and demands are there from employers. So that's actually quite an agile process. We can do that in a year, we can do it within a few weeks. So we can reallocate that funding to ensure that the correct frameworks and the employers' needs have been met on the graduate apprenticeship programmes.
Okay, thank you very much for that, and thanks to the other panel who adds up.
Thank you, James. Michael Mara.
Thank you, Convener. Thanks to the panel for really useful and interesting evidence so far. I wanted to maybe step back to an early comment that I think Frank Mitchell made regarding a particularly high demand for graduate apprenticeships, higher demand than there is supply. Frank, I wonder if you could unpack that a little bit. I mean, in my mind, graduate apprenticeship scheme has been a real success in recent years. Would you agree that's the case?
Yes, I think the graduate apprenticeship is a great innovation and something that I really support both within SDS. As an employer, I think the point I was making is that we currently are funded to provide around 1,350 graduate apprentices, which is great, and we're growing that. But we know that's around about 4,000 we would like to do. So that's an ongoing discussion we're having with Scottish Government about how we can make sure we can do more to meet that demand request around the graduate apprenticeship. It's a great innovation, and there's some companies that are, you know, companies you wouldn't have thought would have been in this marketplace, that are in this marketplace. And the one that I'll quote is JP Morgan, who are using this now as a core recruiting area for them to do to get skills in. So we're seeing this as a real opportunity to get in early to the brightest at school leaver and make sure they get them at that level rather than post-university, where they can be perhaps a different competition and bring people in and not only get them up to a professional level, but also train them in the way that JP Morgan want them to do and actually get a lot more productivity out of them as they're going through. And it's great for the individuals because they're earning and learning. And it's great for the economy because they're paying tax as they go through it. So I think graduate apprentices are absolutely tremendous area. And what all I was commenting on is we already know through our work with employers that they would like to do a lot more in this area.
Yeah, and I think that sounds, you know, it's a real positive that demand's out there, Frank. I appreciate you bringing that to our attention. I suppose I have questions to the Scottish Funding Council in this regard, and to Cairn. Cairn, the University of Scotland, after the budget last week, have expressed real concern that the cost of graduate apprenticeships is to be absorbed within their core budget. Is that the case?
So yes, the Scottish Government has asked us to explore how much of our main core funding could be put towards the apprenticeship programme, both foundation and graduate apprenticeships. I think all I would echo all the comments that Frank makes about how important not only this provision is, but the demand for it is there. And so what we are doing at the minute is we are working through, I mean, this is now what the fourth working day or so after the budget announcement. So we are currently modelling what is possible. We are really, really determined to maintain the current commitment to graduate apprenticeships, which at the minute is something shy of about 1,200 graduate apprenticeships that are being funded. And again, Sharon may have more detailed figures on this. We would like to grow that programme as well. The issue for us will be working very closely with universities on graduate apprenticeships, because there are effectively in the sector probably a handful of universities that are at the forefront of this provision. So you'll have Heriot-Watt, Strathclyde, Glasgow Caledonian, Robert Gordon and Napier are our kind of premier universities in this field. And we have choices to make about how we support those particular universities, because they have invested significantly in specialist teams that are engaging with their employers. They're very successful at doing this. And whether we're having an expectation that all universities are involved in the graduate apprenticeship programme to a greater or lesser extent. But what we are trying to do at the minute with the quantum of funding that we've been given is rapidly model the opportunity that we have to still maintain and sustain this programme, grow it where we can, and make sure that we don't lose this very valuable programme. So we are utterly committed to making this work.
Okay. I mean, it's good to hear that that commitment's there, Karen, and given the success that has been Frank's described and the demand in the economy, I think that's really important. I mean, you'll understand that I would have some concerns about the mechanism around some of that, and you also recognise that essentially funding drives activity, and that one of the reasons that universities across Scotland have invested in this opportunity around graduate apprenticeships is because it's an alternative funding source for the universities. They diversified their activity to drive into this area. I mean, do you foresee that that will remain a separate incentive-based kind of a resource opportunity, or are you looking at mainstreaming this into current grant that is awarded to the universities?
So it's a great question, and it's absolutely, we are in the middle of working through how do we maintain the incentives for this, because While it is a really important part of provision, you're absolutely right, this has been funded through separate funding streams. It has a different kind of cost base and a different kind of interaction between the student and the employer. And therefore, some of the provision to make sure that it's most effective is slightly more expensive than other types of provision. So we have a number of options that we're exploring. It is actually too early. I'm very, very happy to come back to the committee when we have worked through the distribution methodologies. We are likely to bring this forward to our board in March, so we will have a clearer picture of the opportunities. But we have a number of options, including how much of this is incentivized, how much of this is ring fenced, how much of this is mainstreamed through our normal expectations of institutions, because we will have a range of other agreements, for example, our outcome agreements, where we specify the nature of the outcomes that we expect to see from the funding that institutions receive. Early days, absolutely committed to it. It's a little early for me to give you an absolute answer, but very willing to keep engaging on this.
Okay. And just to note, I suppose that we'll keep an eye on this as a committee in terms of these issues regarding the with the willingness of my fellow committee members, but it would be an issue of concern. I mean, I suppose overall we see that in the picture of what last week has been described, I think, as a very disappointing funding settlement for universities. We would want to see that retained, but given that we're talking about skills and skill matches in the economy, can you maybe give some reflections, Cam, in terms of the reaction, I think understandable reaction, of higher education to the funding settlement that came about last week? So important to drive the economy and where we're headed, but we're looking at quite substantial real-term cuts.
So it is a challenging budget settlement, I would say. And that's because if we look at it in the round, we would describe it as fairly much a flat cash baseline settlement. And we have had a commitment, which is incredibly important, that the students who were taken on in the last 2 years, largely an increase in the number of funded places in the university sector, that there has been an additional £21 million to make sure that that cohort effectively completes their studies and are supported to do that. So the government has recognised the commitment to those students, and that is a greater number of funded places than the university sector would have had in, if you like, normal times. But the pandemic has not been normal in terms of the number of students who have been able to and who have wanted to access university education. So I think the issue for us is, again, working with the government's priorities, it is our job to distribute that in a way that does a number of things. It has to maintain the commitment to those students who are going through the system already. It needs to plan for a suitable number of funded places over time. It must accommodate the apprenticeship programme. And I think importantly, It is a settlement and a distribution that needs to make sure that universities and colleges are still able to play their full part in economic recovery. And again, I would say that some of the vital funding that we have seen for upskilling and reskilling and for other forms of interventions are the parts of this jigsaw that we're looking at in terms of, do we distribute in particular ways to fulfil different kinds of missions in the future? And I guess this is the challenge that any funding council will have at the minute. But with this settlement, there are a number of particular pressures, and we're at the middle of modelling all of that for decisions into the new year.
Yeah. I mean, we're looking at no increase in the unit of resource since 2014 per student. Plus, as you describe, actually, an increase in the number of domestic students over the last couple of years, driven by the pandemic. And, I think that has to be protected and a positive thing that we give those opportunities. And then inflation figures that we see today, running at 5%, USS, this is becoming an emerging storm for our higher education sector, isn't it?
So every single institution is in a different position. So there will be some institutions where they have, for want of a better word, ballast, where they have got a range of other options, I guess, for how they think about their sustainability long term. I think our closest attention will come to some of that kind of squeezed middle. So the chartered and the modern universities, where they may have particular cost pressures and do not have the same resource that some of our more ancient and longer established universities will have. And it is a coming together of a number of different pressure points. So we have fewer, for example, European students coming into some of our courses. We have a kind of complex set of cost pressures, as you say, with pensions and other kind of costs. And we have seen the sector also borrow more, either as a result of the pandemic or because of simply the nature of the adjustment that some institutions have had to make. And they have been brilliant, actually, at adjusting their models and how they've operated in a very short period of time. So I guess this is where we will need both fundamental engagement with individual institutions. And of course, we're not out of this pandemic, so we still have a significant amount of concern about how this coming together of the kind of situation that you have described affects not only individual institutions but the sector across the piece.
Okay, thanks, Karen, and thanks, Convener. I could go on at this at length. I think it's a matter of really significant concern and distress in the sector, but I'll leave the questions there for the moment. Thank you.
Thank you, Michael. I'm going to bring in Ross Greer, and Ross, you will be followed by Fergus. Ross.
Thanks, Convener. I've got a couple of specific questions for colleagues from SDS, so direct these at Katie in the first instance. That's okay. It's in relation to the FIPS, the Funding Information and Processing System for Apprenticeships. You might be aware that we took some evidence last week from employers, and an issue with the FIPS was flagged up in relation to the number of hours that an apprentice might complete before they are registered on.
To have a problem with Ross, which is a great pity. We will bring him back in as soon as he reappears. In the meantime, Fergus, would you mind coming in at this point? Oh, hang on, Ross has reappeared. Ross, no, he's disappeared again. I think we'll go with Fergus and then we'll come back to Ross when we've got a stable line with him. Fergus, would you mind coming in?
Not at all, Convener, and good morning to all our witnesses. And just like to start off by saying thank you for all the terrific work that you, your members and your colleagues do throughout Scotland. Over the years, I've seen countless examples, not only in University of the Highlands and Islands, the College, the Forestry College in Balloch, in my own patch, but throughout the country. I've been involved, as some of you know, in a number of matters over the years in a different capacity. And I also think that the material submitted by SDS is really illustrative of a very positive story, not just amongst universities and colleges, many of which are world leading, but also in the scale of apprentices, because we've gone from, as Frank well knows, from 10,579 in the year 2008-2009 to 29,000 10 years later. An increase of threefold in 10 years is a tremendous success, and of course the pandemic has brought unprecedented challenges of that. So I just wanted to preface my remarks by making that general comment in what is a huge topic. But I did want to address two issues today, Convener. Primarily, I think, to Frank, although of course others can chip in if they wish to. But I think two areas where, from what I've seen over 22 years in this institution, is that the needs of rural Scotland and small businesses are quite difficult to accommodate in terms of skills and training in general, for logistical and practical reasons to do with distance, scale. Small businesses don't have an HR department. They tend to be extremely busy just doing their work. They might be two or three people. There could be in small businesses, for example, shared apprenticeships. And I'd like specifically to ask if there is work going on to develop shared apprenticeships. And secondly, I'd like to ask, in relation to rural, whether Frank agrees that really more needs to be done in rural, and whether SDS are committed to doing that, and how the Rural Skills Action Plan, which was launched not that long ago, is faring in terms of meeting the potential of particularly young people in rural Scotland. So, to say, primarily a question to Frank. It's good to see you again, Frank. And I think you've heard me say all of this quite a few times before. Over to you.
Okay, thank you, Mr. Hearing, for your kind comments. And I think a lot of work has been on in this area, as you've rightly identified, and we shouldn't, you know, whereas we always want to improve, but we shouldn't forget successes that have been achieved, and it's good to remind us all of that picture. So So a couple of comments. So what I think we still have a lot of how we define as SMEs who take on apprenticeships, but it's when you get down to the micro businesses, it's very difficult. And I've certainly met with potential employers in rural communities, both in the south of Scotland and in the north of Scotland, who say, you know, I could maybe use an apprentice, but 1 or 2 days a week. And is there any way I could share it with another company? And we are looking again how best we can do that, because we want to be flexible as we can to try and make that happen, because we don't want to have any obstacles to bringing people into the workplace. There's a couple of things that are challenges for us to overcome when we've looked at it. One is we need one of the companies to be the ultimate employer. And I think that's right and proper for the individual, that they know somebody who's the ultimate employer in that setup. And up until now, when we have those discussions, there's been a reluctance in the micro businesses to be the ultimate employer, who's ultimately going to make sure that person has a job when all this is finished. So that's proving a challenging discussion when you have those micro businesses discussion to say, well, who's ultimately going to be the employer? And I can talk about there's other European models where the state become the employer in those circumstances, but there are issues where then somebody then finishes that apprenticeship and then they look around to see the companies they work for to see who's going to be my enduring employer, and sometimes that hasn't proven to be successful for them. So there are practical issues around that, but I well recognise this is a challenge around flexibility and how we do that. The other part of it is being fair to the person in the apprenticeship side, that they are getting the appropriate training from all those micro businesses, and in doing that, and equally well, that the standards of that training on the job are at the level that we think they should be for somebody who's undertaking that. And between micro businesses, you two get different approaches. So I appreciate this challenge, and I've talked to employers in that area. And those are some of the challenges we're trying to overcome to try and get this flexibility to work, and we'll continue looking at it. And I'm sure Katie will comment on it as well. And I think you're right to identify the particular challenges of the rural communities. I remember an example just pre-COVID, where I was down, I think, for one of the South of Scotland meetings. And I was meeting some employers in advance of it, and some apprentices. And there was an alarm company, I'm sure it was in Gala or thereabouts, that the problem they had was that for 1 week a month, their apprentices had to go to Glasgow to do the college training.
Yeah.
And I thought this was a real sort of challenge, both for the individuals and for the businesses, to cope with that upheaval. And so one of the things that I was pushing on is how can we use more and more digitalization to get the training to the individual rather than the individual to the training. And I think, you know, I think that's an area again that I want to keep pushing on again and again, that we shouldn't be having people having to, you know, take a week out of their family life and the business that they're engaged with to go up to one of the, you know, to go up or down to one of the central belt colleges to get trained. So I think we've got to use technology more and more. And one of the benefits of the recent sort of experience through COVID is that ability to deliver training remotely is possible through, you know, academic training. So I think it's broken down some of the barriers, and we can't let that slip back. We've got to keep pushing those opportunities, because I do think the digitalisation frees up a lot of opportunity for rural communities that otherwise would have been barriers for them to get those opportunities. And I think we need to balance that appropriately. There will be a need for classroom teaching, but it shouldn't be as regimented as 1 week a month, regardless of what's going on, to do that. So in doing that, that's what they think we've got to focus on to open up those opportunities. But we do work on the rural skills assessment and the rural investment plans with the various stakeholders. And maybe I'll ask Katie to comment where we are on what you've just asked for. But I recognise the challenge on getting this flexible for micro businesses to work and there are real obstacles we need to overcome. But it's a challenge that I'm very, very sort of focused on. How do we make this work for everybody, including the apprentice? And maybe Katie can comment on the other parts of it.
Yep. Okay. You know, we are a small business economy, so we do have huge representation from small businesses in apprenticeships already, but it is something that you know, we're always wanting to make more inroads in. I think that, particularly in the rural side of things, we've got a rural supplement in the contribution rate, recognising that you know some of the logistical and cost issues around rural side of things. We work very closely with the partners in the local area. You probably know that we've got a charter with the Western Isles, and that model is going to be used for other areas of Scotland. When we contract for apprenticeships with the Development South of Scotland Agency, we now identify what we need in the Highlands and Islands in terms of demand. We identify what we need in terms of the South of Scotland too. And we've got staff dedicated to working with partners in these areas to look at the whole, you know, what rural areas need. The comments I'd add to what Frank said about shared apprenticeships, one or the other, we have got, we're working with the South of Scotland at the moment on developing the model there, and the key focus at the moment is the demand side of that. And we've had other models in Angus and other areas. One of the other issues, apart from the employment status of the individual and who will bear the costs of it, is that it can also be detrimental to the young people in terms of moving about employers. So it's like going through induction again, you're the newbie in the workplace, etc. So there are some practical issues there. And also we've found in some of the models that we've had is that some employers won't pay play ball, and once they've got the individual, they won't hang on to them as well. So there are just some sort of practical things, but rural and SMEs is very, you know, a key focus for us, particularly within apprenticeships, and also the work that we do on skills planning and partnerships.
I wonder. Thanks to Frank and Katie for your answers, and you know everything you've said I've recognised from previous discussions. Very practical issues. So I won't repeat that. I agree entirely with the analysis and the points you've made, all very reasonable. I do feel that the shared apprenticeship is a model that hasn't yet been cracked, but could be. And you know, I wonder whether it might be worth you engaging further with small business representatives, both the generic ones such as the FSB, but also particular trades associations that are very often very well informed about the details, such as SNPF, you know, and plumbers and electricians and so on. I think they've got a lot to offer in terms of practical driving things forward. But I do accept that we've got to look at the interests of the young people as well as the employer, quite obviously. And the point that Frank makes about digital, using digital rather than kids having to travel, you know, 100 miles to a classroom, that must surely happen if we've learned anything from the pandemic. I wonder if I could just finish just by asking for two things, convener, following this meeting, not just right now, but one is, would it be possible for SDS to provide us with some statistics about the performance in rural and small business, insofar as you're able to have them? I appreciate that the compilation of statistics is in itself involves classification definition issues, but nonetheless, I really do think we really need to have a picture of what is happening in rural and small business, particularly as we're a small business country. And finally, it's just a specific plug, which is that there is a scheme involving training for young people, a pre-apprenticeship scheme, and I believe apprenticeship scheme with an organisation called Ringlink, which is a farming machinery and labour cooperative operating in the northeast and elsewhere in Scotland. And as Frank knows, they did set up an excellent scheme for young people, which I think provides a great model to be rolled out throughout Scotland in farming, involving groups of farmers providing training for a whole host of young people. And I'm very keen, because I know that they were funded on a pilot basis, convener, until 2021. So I was keen to see that funding continues and is mainstreamed by SDS. I say I don't expect the witnesses, because I didn't raise this with them before, to answer it now. And, you know, I never like to try and ambush anybody, do I? But perhaps they could take away both those questions and get back to us, please, if they may.
Seems like a very fair summary and a couple of fair requests from Fergus Ewing. But I do see that Frank Mitchell and Sharon Drysdale wanted to come back in response to the line of questions that you had raised. Frank and then Sharon, and then we'll go to Oliver Mundell. While Ross has had a few technical problems, we'll come back to Ross after we've heard from Oliver Mundell. But first, Frank and then Sharon.
Thank you again, Mr. Ewing. So we will, hopefully you can hear me, we will take those away and come back to you. And Ringlink is a great training initiative, joint training initiative, which is completely different from shared employment, but the point is well made, and we'll take that on and come back to you what we're doing in the rural communities and answer your questions. What I forgot to mention, which I was something I wanted to in this context, which I think is really something the for the committee to take on board, particularly for the rural communities, is the work we did with the Western Isle Charter. But it's not just about the job and the apprenticeship, but it's about housing and a whole lot of other things. And that really innovative approach we did in the Western Isles, that charter and the work we're doing with other islands is equally applicable to some rural communities on the mainland as well, where it's really about not just about the job, it's about all housing, etc., and a whole lot of other factors that are important for people to stay, you know, particularly working age people to stay in those communities. So I think the other thing we'll share with you, if you don't have it at hand, is that Western Isle Charter, which has now been started to be adopted by other communities now, which I really think is a real innovative approach to try and tackle some of the, not just the training issues, but the people shortages of a working age happening in the rural communities. That's what I wanted to add to the comments so far.
Thank you. Thank you, Frank. Sharon, have you something to add to that too?
Just one small thing. Round about the ability of employers and small SMEs in the rural areas to be able to access training and upskilling provision. I'm really reluctant to say that there was any silver lining in the pandemic. However, in very challenging times, our institutions converted a lot of their online training for Flex Workforce Development Fund and upskilling to online and virtual environments. So for Flex Workforce Development Fund, we went from having 5% of all learning online to 60% in a very short period of time. This has enabled more SMEs in all areas across Scotland to access it. Maybe this is something we just need to expand and market a bit better so that those SMEs in rural areas are aware of this provision and can access it more fully. We'll look to do something about that marketing.
As you say, silver linings in the pandemic are hard to find, but there are some lessons that we can usefully forward. Thank you, Fergus, for your questions and for those responses. And now I'm going to go to Oliver Mundell, and then Ross, I think, is back online. Oliver first, though.
Hi, thank you, convener. I don't want to sort of make a statement, but I feel it would be remiss in light of the previous comments just not to reference the fact that for many people in rural areas, online is a positive, but there are also benefits from learning with other people in person. And I just ask, you know, that the Funding Council and others are mindful of that, which relates to my substantive question, which is whether the Funding Council feel that there's enough support under the current model going to rural education providers, and whether the additional costs of delivering education in rural communities at higher and further education level is fully reflected.
Who do you want to bring in?
Karen Moore.
Right, thank you. Karen.
Thanks very much. So as part of, we do this in a number of different ways. So the first thing I would say is part of our funding model provides a premium for institutions working predominantly in rural areas. So we're recognising in the way we distribute funds an additional amount of cost that goes into reaching out, making sure that communities are well served, and in, as you rightly say, Mr. Mundell, not just having online opportunities, but the cost of making sure that local communities are well served in person and in community. So, for example, in the Highlands and Islands area, we are we have a significant amount of premium going into these colleges and university provision. The second point I would make is in areas like, for example, the south of Scotland, where we have similar challenges, and I would say probably in the round for colleges alone, it's something like an additional 10 million across the country in particular rural areas. That is specifically to recognise the challenges and the opportunities in rural areas of learning and teaching in those settings. But I would say the second point is, in areas like the south of Scotland, we are very keen, and it's why we have talked about our Pathfinder projects, where we're very keen to look again at whether we have the right kind of provision, the right kind of engagement with employers, the right kind of responsiveness in the system to make sure that that needs are fully looked at, not just from employers, but from student needs and that pathway through from school, college, up to higher education and beyond. And also making sure that in particular areas, people are not always having to travel outside a particular area to get to higher education where there isn't a particular university close by. So in all of that, I would say, obviously more we could can do. And secondly, I think the Pathfinders are a way of testing whether we've quite got it right. And we've deliberately chosen the south of Scotland as a rural area with less higher education opportunity than we might see in other parts of the country. I'll stop there and see if that's answering the question that you've posed.
Yeah, that's starting to answer the question, and I'm pleased as someone who represents a constituency in the south of Scotland that you're looking at a specific programme there. But my concern is still around this. You used the word predominantly when you were talking about the institutions who get support. You look at the Crichton campus in Dumfries, and I see the University of West of Scotland, the University of Glasgow, who would typically be seen as more urban-based new institutions. I just wonder what more support can be provided to them. And I have a particular concern, and it's probably broader than just rural areas, but whilst we continue with a model where institutions are funded on a fees-only basis to provide courses, it's difficult to see how those places can be fully supported in outreach campuses, and how students who are learning remotely can get the support they need, particularly off the back of the pandemic, where there are broader issues identified around sort of mental health, student support, and sort of wider wellbeing. So anything you could add on that would be helpful.
So first of all, I won't go into the fees only issue, but that is a choice that universities make in terms of marginal cost of their places and how they choose to fill them. We fully fund a significant number of places. But
is it right to say that you sign off on those places and you provide the funding?
We fully fund places, and then universities choose whether they bring in students into either classes where they can accommodate other learners, where they only get a staff student fee for that, rather than
funded
placement.
You agree that with them? You agree that with them, though, as part of
the role. It's actually their choice. So we look at, so we don't, if you like, sign off the fees only part of it. We sign off the funded places. If I could pick up, though, the points you're quite rightly making about whether we have the right kind of provision in some areas. I mean, the reason why I pick up the Pathfinders, because we've had very active engagement in West of Scotland, Glasgow University, to a lesser extent, Heriot Watt in the Borders, but in the Dumfries and Galloway, and the Crichton campus has been tremendously important in providing a physical place for those universities to have a footprint in the south of Scotland. again, through the Pathfinders, I think we'd like to test further the nature of that engagement, whether there are other relationships that could develop between the colleges and other universities in Scotland, or how those colleges themselves might develop their higher education offer in situ. So I guess I would say very happy to keep in close contact with you as those Pathfinders develop, because they are aware of testing whether we've quite got it right in some particular areas.
Yeah, I'll leave it there for now, Convener, but I thank you for that.
Thank you, Oliver. And we've finally turned to Ross, who I think we've got now on a stable link.
Thanks, Convener. Just want to absolutely make sure. Can you hear and see me okay?
You can indeed. Nice to see you and nice to hear from you.
Excellent, thanks. So I've got a couple of specific questions for SDS colleagues, so perhaps for directing these to Katie in the first instance. You might be aware that when we took evidence last week, some of it was from employers, one of whom flagged up some concerns they had with FIPS, the system for the SDS system for registering apprenticeships. And essentially the issue that was raised with us was that an apprenticeship that was lodged, that was processed with FIPS, it couldn't account for any time served before the point of registration. Therefore, the example they used was if they had started an apprentice at their company over the summer, but only sorted out the FIPS registration now, all the time that apprentice had been with them wouldn't count towards the time served element of the apprenticeship. It would therefore extend the duration of the apprenticeship beyond what would be desirable either to the apprentice or to the employer, or they mentioned the concerns of trade unions as well. In the first instance, could you just clarify what the technical requirements are there? Is it possible to register and process an apprenticeship through FIPS and backdate the time served, or is it only time that's served from the point of registration onwards that counts? Sorry, Katie, you're not.
Katie's speaking, but yet. We can't hear her.
There you go. That's you now. Sorry, if you could start again.
Okay, sorry about that. So the point about FIPS is that an apprenticeship is recognised, and it's a contractual requirement that when an apprentice starts and they're in receipt of, you know, it's the public funding, i.e. through the contract, is offered via SDS, that they are registered on FIPS. Registering them on FIPS then makes sure that all the rules have been followed in terms of has that person had an initial assessment, has the training plan been developed, etc., blah, blah, blah. That, you know, all the things that are needed to put in place for support, and it's formally registered. Scottish Government only recognise apprenticeships that are registered in FIPS, as do HMRC. HMRC use, we are required to give HMRC data on who on our system and who are apprentices, and that's where they do their checks in terms of the minimum wage for apprenticeships as well. So it's really important that they're registered on FIPS right away, because then all that contractual requirement kicks in about have they had a service in terms of understanding their needs. It could be that the individual has got special needs, so do we know that that's been catered for too?
Thanks very much for that. So I understand entirely the need to register with FIPS. Just to clarify then, the reasons that you've just cited there, i.e. HMRC compliance, etc., that means that you couldn't retrospectively register with FIPS. Nothing. Someone could nominally have taken on an apprentice. It could be someone working with an employer with the title of apprentice, but until the moment they're registered with FIPS, that can't count towards time served. That's
it shouldn't be, because they should be there from, they should be on the system from the start, absolutely. And obviously HMRC would only recognise them as an apprentice if they were doing the follow-up sampling as when the time that they were on FIPS.
And how are employers supported to make sure that their apprentices are on FIPS? Forgive me, I'm not familiar with how long the FIPS system has been in operation for. I don't know whether this is relatively new or something that's been around for a while now.
got a direct contract with us, they don't need to bother about that. That's the duty of the contracted provider. So their duty is to do all the paperwork, and that's one of the reasons we have contracted providers, and we've got a lot of SMEs involved in FIPS, so that they don't have to do the paperwork. All of that is done by the contracted training provider.
And the context was about a wider concern when it came comes to the consultation with involvement of employers in the development of SDS policy systems like FIPS. That was what was used as the example. But there was a wider frustration raised in that previous session about having employers in the room, giving them a voice as these systems are developed. So, taking on board what you've just said, which has been really useful around what involvement they actually have in the use of the system, when systems like this are being developed, what kind of user testing, consultation, etc., do you do with employers so that they're clear on exactly how this operates, what their role is or isn't, and how they should engage with the system and how they should engage with providers?
As I say, the system won't really touch the employers. That's the duty of the contracted training providers to actually fill in the paperwork and complete the system. It's just a giant database. That's all it is. And that's where you get the details of who's involved, what background, what area do they live in, all these sort of the good things that you then see coming out in the annual reports. We do consult with the people who use the system. In the development of the system, we had a working group with contracted training providers. And every time there's a new development on it, we work with them and test it. Some of the points that were made last week were about representation in terms of engagement with the construction industry. Construction industry is complex. It's got many subsectors and it's lots of very small companies. It's one of the longest, it's probably the longest standing apprenticeship. So there's very strong views. And there's lots of groups, and we've got, some of them say they represent the whole industry, but they don't. There's other parts of it. We've got multiple touch points with the construction industry. We've got a sector manager devoted to construction skills. We engage with the industry leadership group, which is the recognised group in terms of engagement, and that's got a skills subgroup. And some of the people that we're speaking to you are on that, and these federations that they were also talking about. And the ILG skills subgroup, for instance, it has an influence in terms of estimating what the demand every year is for modern apprenticeships, graduate and foundation apprenticeships. There's also a construction industry leadership group, which is a skills subgroup. And there was a COVID recovery group works team with an MA task force that involved all the federations, the colleges and ourselves as part of it. There's also a new qualification construction skills council has been set up, and we are members of that. And there's good representation in all of the SAB groups from the construction industry. And in fact, Mr. Mitchell, who was mentioned, I think maybe Alan said this earlier, who gave evidence last week, he's been on the standards and frameworks group of SAB since its inception. So I think there's absolutely multiple touch points. And, one of the biggest growth areas for modern apprenticeships over the last 4 years has been in construction. We've had over 2,000 more starts over the last few years. And that, in fact, the industry estimated in 1920 just under 6,000 starts, and actually 150 more were achieved due to the demand.
Thanks very much. I think you've really helpfully clarified this for us, Katie, so I really appreciate that. So just one final question based on what we've heard previously. I mean, are you aware of, not even widespread, are you aware of it, multiple instances of there being a delay between someone starting an apprenticeship role and registration? Is this an issue that you were familiar with before it was raised with us last week?
So we became aware of it over the last wee while there, and we've been working with the contractor concerned about what arrangements they're putting in place to get everybody registered on the system. There has been a bit of a perfect storm, obviously, for the construction industry, and you can imagine the nature of the industry itself, you're on site, etc., and also the nature of the training that goes on in workshops has been hugely affected by furlough. And also in terms of the physical distancing. So you've got people who started last year, you've got people starting this year, people who started in previous years, there's been a bit of a delay to what's happening there. So there's a lot going on, but in that specific registration issue, we're working with the contractors concerned. We've got weekly meetings with them to make sure that any backlog is caught up in terms of our contracted numbers.
Thanks very much. So this is a specific issue with the one contractor, the one provider. You're not encountering multiple instances of this.
Not that we're aware of at all. At construction, this has been a specific issue with one contractor, and as I say, it's due to a range of things, and there's a number of measures they're putting in place as well to catch up.
Thanks very much. I think I'll leave it there, Convener. I think that really helpfully clarified this issue for us. I'm really grateful to Katie for that detail.
Thank you, and thank you, Ross. We're 2 hours, 20 minutes into this hearing, and I cannot thank Frank Mitchell, Katie Hutton, Dr. Alan Calhoun, Karen Watt and Sharon Drysdale enough for the evidence they've given us today. It's been very, very insightful, very, very helpful, and I hope that you feel it's been good use of your time, because we certainly have valued your contributions today. The public part of today's meeting is now at an end. I will now suspend the meeting and can ask members to reconvene on Microsoft Teams, which will allow us to consider our final agenda item in private. Thank you again, and have a good day.